Girls with no fathers in the home have lower self-esteem. Okay, fine, that sucks, but also women with low self-esteem are more promiscuous. No father families more likely to be victims of abuse, especially with single mothers. The more opportunities a child has to interact with biological father, the less likely they are to commit a crime or have contact with a juvenile justice system. Okay, another way to say that is men and women who are incarcerated, the population of the prisons mostly encompass fatherless homes. Now here's something that no one else has mentioned, which I think is cool, and I don't really say this eloquently. If a man and wife raise a child, they're less likely to end up in jail, but they have the same statistical chance as children raised by just their father. So if we want to keep children, adults, out of prison, mother, father, or just father? Well, we don't want to hear just father, so let's try to keep the families intact. I think that just seems better.
Perhaps these women, these single women, should consider being in a polygamous relationship. It will show that they're more concerned about their sons and daughters. Think about it.
To you today about is polygamy. So, you know, this is a very sensitive subject to many of the sisters because, you know, you're coming out of Western, you know, mindsets, and, you know, now you're trying to be Israelite, and many of you grapple with the task of trying to accept polygamy. And many of you that can't accept that, you go to a camp that may teach that, well, polygamy is sinful. The first thing that I want to say is that polygamy is not sinful. Polygamy is permitted in the Bible. So if you give me approximately 45 minutes of your time, I'm going to prove this beyond the shadow of a doubt with scriptures. So hear me well. And, you know, I'm bringing this out to the spirit. Now, I would like to please point out that me, you know, providing this lecture, I'm not in no way trying to promote the practice of polygamy, and I'm not, you know, de-promoting or trying to establish a non-practice of polygamy, but this lecture is intended, you know, to actually prove that according to the Bible, you know, that polygamy is lawful. This lecture is not about, you know, me promoting polygamy because this is my personal preference, or this is the personal preference of Tazi Doc Shah. No, that's not it. But it is intended to prove that the Bible is, you know, giving us various scriptures where polygamy is lawful. And I challenge anyone to come against this. I don't, you know, care that you may refer to yourself as an elder, a deacon, you know, and so on and so forth. If you try to, you know, the doctrine that you're teaching that polygamy is unlawful and is a sin is a false doctrine, and I intend to prove that, you know, with scriptures. You know, it's just my intent to clear things up. And somehow, while doing that, I have the tendency to continuously step on the feet of those that, you know, do not like truth. You know, as I previously stated in various videos, truth seems to be the new hate speech. And those that hate the truth hate, you know, the barrier of the truth and the truth itself. But nevertheless, you know, so there's some people going around teaching that, and teaching their followers that, you know, they're only entitled to have one wife. You know, and that's not scripture. That's not scripture. And if you stay tuned, if you tune into this video long enough, you're gonna find out that what I'm telling you is true. And those of you sisters just listening, you're gonna have to get over your emotion, and you're gonna have to detach that westernized mindset and return to the scriptures and see it for what it is. You know, essentially, it's not up to you whether or not your husband decides that he wants to accept another wife. You must understand that. And I'm telling you that through the spirit, not through a dictatorship, or, you know, something like that. Or but I'm just telling you through the spirit of truth. So, you know, this lecture is not an attack on, you know, Israel united in Christ, but it's simply reflecting what Scripture says on this topic of polygamy. And, you know, attempts to answer the question, is polygamy a sin? You know, for example, me or I, Tazadot, have no intention of taking another wife. So that's not why I'm doing this lecture. Now, even though in the laws of the Most High, again, polygamy is allowed. But, you know, personally as a man, and you as another man may, you know, it may be your personal preference to not want to take another wife. So understand that. But, you know, have you ever wondered why? So those of you under the sound of my voice, now listen very well. I want you to think. You have the ability to think for yourself. Do not allow others to dictate your thinking. Now, a question. Have you ever wondered why the Most High never condemned polygamy in the Bible? Show me a scripture where it's condemned. And it's not hard to prove in the Old Testament, which we're going to prove through the Spirit, and in the New Testament, that polygamy was valid and still is a valid form of marriage. And it is not sinful. And it is not sinful. So the scriptures are clear that polygamy was and still is today a valid form of marriage for the man. Now, I'm going to point out straight, sisters. Polygamy is unlawful for you. So, I mean, don't get upset with me. That's just the way that the Most High made it. And any of you out there, like many of you more sisters engaging in polygamous relationships, you're what the Bible referred to as a harlot. The modern day word for that is a whore. You are a hoe. Now, don't get under your emotions, but listen to me. Because sometimes words are really touchy-touchy, filly-filly, but try and receive this in the spirit that is actually being presented. Not from an insulting manner, but from a truthful manner. Now, nowhere in the Bible does the Most High, Yahweh, condemns godly men from having more than one wife. Nowhere. I challenge any of you to show me one scripture where the Most High condemns godly men for having more than one wife. Abraham had a wife, and then he married her maid. Book of Genesis 16, verse 2. And Sarah said unto Abraham, behold, now that the Lord hath restrained me from bearing, I pray thee, go unto my maid, it may be that I may obtain children by her. And Abram hearkened to the voice of Sarah. Verse 3. And Sarah, Abraham's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, after Abraham had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress was despaired in her eyes. As we see, Abraham took another wife. Point one, Jacob married Leah and Rachel. Genesis, the 29th chapter, and Genesis 31:23. And it came to pass in the evening that he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to him. And he went in unto her. And Laban gave unto his daughter Leah, Zilpah, his maid, for a handmaid. And it came to pass in the morning, behold, it was Leah. And he said to Laban, what is that thou hast done unto me? Did not I serve thee with Rachel? For Rachel? Wherefore then hast thou begotten me? And Laban said, it must not be so done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her week, and we will give thee also for the services which thou shalt serve with me yet 7 other years. And Jacob did so and fulfill her week, and he gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife also. And Laban gave to Rachel, his daughter, Bilhah, his handmaid to be her maid. And he went into Rachel, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, and served with him yet 7 other years. Book of Genesis 31 and 17. Then Jacob rose up and set his sons and his wives upon camels. So we see our forefather Jacob had more than one wife. So why are you teaching that it is unlawful to have, you know, more than one wife? That polygamy is a sin. Book of Genesis 32 and 22. And he rose up that night and took his wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons and passed over the fort Jabbok, and then married Leah, Rachel's handmaid, Zilpah and Bilhah. So he married the handmaids as well. You see that? You see that? Genesis 31 through 24 and Genesis 37, 2. Now, the judge, because, you know, the judge of Gideon had many wives and a concubine. Now, he was a judge. Book of Judges, the 8th chapter, verse 30. And Gideon had 70 sons, and his body begotten, for he had many wives. For he had many wives. Verse 31. And his concubine, that was Shechem, she also bare him a son whose name he called Imelech. So we see he had many wives. Now, Elkanah married Hannah and Peninnah. 1 Samuel's, the first chapter, verse 1. Now, there was a certain man, Ramtamazah, Zephon, of Mount Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Eliu, the son of Tuhu, the son of Zeph, an Ephratite. And he had 2 wives. And he had 2 wives. The name of the one, Hannah, and the name of the other, Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. So again, we see through the scriptures, again, polygamy, again and again and again and again. So why are you teaching that polygamy is unlawful? That is a sin. And I know what you're going to say. You're going to try and use the New Testament, but we're going to get to that as well. Just stay tuned. Now, King David married Abigail and Ahinoam, 1 Samuel 25 and 42. And Abigail hasted and arose and rode upon an ass with 5 damsels of hers that went after her. And she went after the messenger of David and became his wife. David also took Ahinoam and Jezreel, and they were also both of them his wives. So we see David, the king of Israel, had more than one wife. 1 Samuel 30 verse 18. And David recovered all the Amalekites and carried away, and David rescued his 2 wives. Then later took more wives at Jerusalem. So, why are you teaching that polygamy is not lawful? Why are you teaching that polygamy is a sin and it is prohibited and not permitted? That is a false doctrine. Stop it. Stop it now. Stop it now. Stop it now. 2 Samuel 5 and 13. And David took him more concubines and wives out of Jerusalem after he was come from Hebron. And there were yet sons and daughters born to David. You see that? You can't get away from this. What are we reading? We're reading in the Old Testament. 1 Chronicles 14, verse 3. More scriptures on it. Now in 2 Samuel 12, 7 and 8, the Most High gave David these multiple wives as a blessing, just as anointing him to king over Israel was a blessing, protecting him from Saul was a blessing, and giving him the house of Israel and Judah was also blessings from the Most High. King Solomon, his son, the son of David, had 700 wives and 300 concubines. 1 Kings 11, 1 through 3. As for Mary, Hillel, and Naharah. 1 Chronicles 4, verse 5. You see that? You see that? Abijah had 14 wives. When you read 2 Chronicles 13 and 21. So why are you teaching that polygamy is unlawful? That it is wrong for a man to have more than one wife? When we find it throughout the scriptures. Now, the scripture that many brothers in Israel United in Christ has been taught to use, that Nathaniel has taught you to use, is that a bishop should be the husband of one wife. I'm going to break that down in detail, but you got to remember, when you look up the word bishop, you know, it's, you know, essentially it means an elder. An elder priest, you know, that's in charge of people. So, you know, basically, the doctrine that many of you are pushing is that, well, since he is a priest and he's an elder, you know, if he's a bishop, it's going to distract his attention away from, you know, the priesthood. But let's see, you know, if we can find in scripture where a priest took more than one wife. Now, when we go and look at 2 Chronicles 24 and 3, we find it right there. Jehoiada, the priest, had two wives in 2 Chronicles 24 and 3. And Jehoiada took for him two wives, and he begat sons and daughters. So we see. So obviously, you have Paul's statement confused in Titus. And we're going to get to that. I'm going to get to that. Because that's a scripture that some love to use to try and justify, you know, the falsehood that, you know, a man in this day and age can't have more than one wife. Now also, the Most High never condemned even the ungodly men from having more than one wife. Lamech, in Genesis 4 and 19, he had more than one wife. King Rehoboam, despite how off he was, he had 18 wives. When you read 2 Chronicles 11 and 21, and 2 Chronicles 11 and 21, and Rehoboam loved Maachah, the daughter of Absalom, above all his wives and his concubines, for he took 18 wives and 80 concubines, and begat 28 sons and 80 daughters. See that? You see that? So, what happens, brothers and sisters, when we go over to the New Testament, we find the brother Paul referring to polygamy of Abraham without any hint that it was sinful when we read Galatians 4 and 24. Book of Galatians 4 and 24. Which things are an allegory for those are the two covenants. The one from Mount Sinai, which generated to bondage, which is Agar. So, you know, essentially, when we study the Old Testament's law concerning polygamy, we find that when the singular wife is used, those laws could apply to monogamy or polygamy. You see that? Deuteronomy 22 and 13. And Deuteronomy 22 and 22. Now, and when we find the plural wives is used, those laws only apply to polygamy. In Deuteronomy 21, 15 through 17. Understand that. Understand that. So the law stated that a man could take another wife as long as he still provided for his first wife in the book of Exodus 21 and 10. Let's get it. And if he take him another wife, her food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall not diminish. Now, this is what the Apostle Paul calls due benevolence in 1 Corinthians 7 verse 3. 1 Corinthians 7 verse 3. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolent, and likewise also unto the wife, the husband. Now, we know that the Lord protected the rights of the firstborn son concerning his inheritance in the case where the father preferred another wife over that son's mother in Deuteronomy 21:15-17. Now, the law commanded that any man who had sex with a virgin was to marry her. That constitutes marriage. Deuteronomy 22:28. And if a man find a damsel that is a virgin, that is not betrothed, she's not engaged to anyone else, about to get married with anyone else, and lay hold of her, and lie with her, and they be found, then the man that lay with her shall give unto the damsel's father 50 shekels of silver, and she shall be his wife, because he hath humbled her, he may not put her away or his days. You see that? So there is nothing in that text, brothers and sisters, that supports the idea that only single men are to marry in this instance. The Lord protected and ensured the woman that her food, her claim, her clothing, and her marital rights and duties would not be diminished. It doesn't say that the man only had to have that particular wife. This also protected the woman from the reproach of not being able to find another man to be her husband because she was no longer a virgin. And furthermore, the reproach of possibly never being able to have children. So the man, single or married, needed to be responsible for his fornication if he committed it, and the woman needed to be protected. So the law commanded that a man to marry the widow of his deceased brother's wife. To marry his deceased brother's wife. The law commanded that if he had no children with her in Deuteronomy 25:5-10. And again, there is nothing in the text that supports that this law was limited only to single brothers, meaning brothers that didn't have a wife yet. There's nothing in the law that states that. So stop trying to use trichotomy. So the Lord did have some restrictions on polygamy. What were those restrictions? Restrictions such as a man not marrying the sister of his wife in the book of Leviticus 18-17 and in Leviticus 20:14. Now, another restriction that was actually admonished the king against the acquisitions of too many wives, having too many wives in Deuteronomy 17:17. And in that particular, these foreign wives that would turn you away from, you know, the Most High, because they would tempt you towards their gods in 1 Kings 11, verse 1 through 8. And Solomon, King Solomon sinned, not because of the fact that, you know, he may have had too many wives, but because he married women from foreign nations. He married heathens. And he did not tear down, even worse, he did not destroy their places of worship of their false gods, as ordered in Deuteronomy 7, verse 3. That's the law. So, brothers, sisters, it may also appear that Solomon could have actually broken the law in that he multiplied 700 wives and 300 concubines to himself, you know, in 1 Kings 11:3. And Solomon may have abused the right to take more than, you know, the wives, then he could actually sexually satisfy their needs by having so many women. But David, on the other hand, David did not break this law. You know, that was discussed in 2 Samuel 12, verse 7 and 8. Well, I hit you with that scripture, 2 Samuel 12, 7 and 8 earlier. Now, a lot of you, you know, when you get, you know, to the New Testament, that's where you go off, because you can see beyond a shadow of a doubt, I prove right here in the Old Testament that polygamy is definitely permitted and not prohibited. So let's look at the New Testament now. So we're going to take a look at the New Testament now. Now, a lot of you, you know, just like some of the churches, you teach that polygamy is adultery. That's off as hell. Many falsely teach that polygamy is adultery. And at one time, you know, I'll be honest, I thought polygamy was not allowed, you know, after Yahweh Shah. But that's not true either. After going back and re-examining the scriptures, after actually going back and really taking the time to study the matter, I see that it is permitted. Now, since adultery is punishable by death, according to Leviticus 20 and 10, and Deuteronomy 22 and 22 through 23, adultery is punishable by death. Now, all of you are committing adultery, I want you to keep that in mind. Adultery, I'm going to say it again. Adultery is punishable by death under the penalty of death according to Leviticus 20 verse 10 and Deuteronomy 22 verse 22 through 23. And the law regulated, as I explained earlier, through the Spirit, that polygamy is allowed. So all of you that's teaching a lie that polygamy is adultery, you're off. You're confounded in your own folly. So, you know, in certain instances, adultery cannot be seen as synonymous with polygamy. Men and their wives were not put to death for having polygamous marriages. You can't show me anywhere in the scriptures that a man was put to death for having polygamous marriages. Show me. So it's very important that we look into the scriptures to define what adultery really is. Because all of those out there that's teaching, polygamy is adultery, that's awesome. Adultery is sleeping with another man's wife, is sleeping with another married person. Or adultery is, you know, a woman going to sleep with another woman's husband. So instead of holding on to your westernized definition of adultery, you have to look to the scriptures to see what adultery really is. And to you sisters, that's against polygamy. You have to look to the scriptures, not what Reverend, Chicken Wing is telling you, or T.D. Snakes is telling you, or, you know, Al Short Tongue. So, in the United States, adultery is seen as a married individual, man or woman, having sexual intercourse with someone of the opposite sex. They say that's adultery. If you have sex and you're married and you go out and sleep with a woman that's not married, they say that's adultery. But according to the law, it's not. The other person has to be married as well. Understand that. So U.S. law on this matter, brothers and sisters, essentially reflects the ideas of the Roman culture and the apostate Roman Catholic Church. That's the doctrine that you're following. And is not aligned with the laws, statutes, and commandments of the Most High. So the scripture's view of the wife is that she is the property of a husband. You can like it, understand it, believe it or not, but that's the view that the scripture gives. So therefore, any man who's actually had relations with her, if she's married, if you went out and you had a relation with a woman that's married already, then you're guilty of breaking the eighth commandment also. You shall not steal, because you stole another man's wife. And he was put to death along with the adulteress's wife. That's the punishment. So as I already discussed earlier, if a single married man had sex with a virgin or an unmarried woman, he was commanded to marry her. Book of Deuteronomy 22, verse 22. If a man be found laying with a woman married to a husband, then she shall... Let me read it again and read it right. Deuteronomy 22 and 22. If a man shall be found laying with a woman married to an husband, then they shall both of them die, both the man that lay with the woman and the woman. So shall thou put away evil from Israel. So you see, this is not a lightweight matter. Now many of you could see why I got so upset when Elder confirmed that, certain people was committing adultery and did nothing about it. But, that's another story. Now, a lot of you, you push a forced doctrine that polygamy violates, the two shall become as one. And you don't understand that. So, what you're saying, if a man has more than one wife, he can't be one with all of them. See, that's twisting the scriptures. And a novice would actually not understand that. So neither God nor Moses saw any violation or contradiction of Genesis 2 and 24 to the law, which not only allowed polygamy, but as I earlier pointed out, in some cases, commanded it if the man slept with a virgin. So it would be, strange. Pathetic, to try to establish, some kind of monogamous law that actually excludes or somehow condemns polygamy. Because that's what you guys are trying to do. Book of Genesis 2 and 24. Therefore, shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Now, those of you that's not well versed in scriptures, they could pull this scripture in a confusion. They make you think, well, if he has more than one wife, then he's not becoming one with all of them. Scripture is not alluding to that. The scripture is not alluding to that at all. Now, Yahushua's point, or Yeshua's point, in Matthew 19, verse 4 through 6, when he cites Genesis 2 and 24, is that, the indissolubility of marriage. Because he says, therefore, what Yahweh has joined together, let not man separate. So the expression one flesh, and as far as it actually relates to the structure of marriage, is essentially referring to the indissolubility of a man and his wife within a marriage, whether it be a monogamous relationship or whether it be a polygamous relationship. This was the point that the Lord was actually bringing out and quoting Genesis passage. So in no way was the Hamashiach condemning polygamy. Now, you say, well, what about St. Paul? What about St. Paul's expression, expression of one flesh? Now, the Pauline usage, would actually illustrate, the broadness and flexibility of the Old Testament's expression. And what do you mean by that, Tyler? Well, for Paul, this unity in the flesh is not confined to, the congenital unity, a union of one husband and one wife. And nor was it limited to, the bonds of, kinship. So even a man who joins himself to a prostitute, for that matter, became one flesh with a prostitute. Understand that. Let's prove all things. 1 Corinthians 6 and 16 through 17. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot, which is a whore, a prostitute, is one body? So you're one body with the whore. For two, saith he, shall be one flesh, but he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. So, this kind of unity, brothers and sisters, is obviously not exclusive in the way that a monogamous union is supposed to be. So for a man, it could be, he could become one flesh with a number of prostitutes, according to this scripture. So according to this use of the expression, we must understand it would actually follow also that a man becomes one flesh with more than one wife in the society. If he has three wives, he becomes one flesh with each of the three wives. With each of the three wives. Just like, you know, if a sinful prostitute can become one flesh with many men, because everyone she lay with, the scripture we just brought out, she becomes one flesh. And 1 Corinthians 16:16-17, she becomes one flesh with every man that she lay with. Understand that. One flesh. So she becomes one flesh with many men. Then why would it be so inconceivable to you brothers over there that a godly man like David could have been one flesh with the wives that the Most High gave him? He was one flesh with them all. So individually, each Israelite that is joined to, you know, Yahweh Shah is one spirit with him, according to 1 Corinthians 6:17. So just as another Israelite's union with Yahweh Shah does not in any way destroy the witness of my union with Yahweh Shah, so it is that a man may be one flesh with more than one wife. Understand that, and overstand that. So Yahweh Shah, Christ knows, receives, and becomes one spirit with his virgins. Matthew 25:1-13. So brothers and sisters, it is essentially important to recall that the real background to marriage in ancient Israel, Yasha Allah, the background against which the biblical passages on marriage are to be seen, was the larger community of the family and the clan. So marriage was not understood primarily in terms of the husband-wife relationship, and certainly not in terms of exclusive relationship between only two persons. Marriage was regarded as a social instrument required for the preservation and continuations of families and clans of the nation of Yasha Allah. So through daughters being married into different families, there was a mutual strengthening of kinship, of bonds, each family giving its own flesh and blood to other families. Do you understand? So that's what it is, brothers. One flesh is not confined exclusively to only two persons. You must understand that. The several children of one mother, you know, for instance, a woman has four children. Are they not all one flesh with her? By reasons of their unity and generations and in their maternal love, are they not one flesh with her? The relationship between the mother and each of those children, respectively, may even be regarded as a union of two and one flesh. So, without excluding the other children. It's simple. So, from this same relationship with the mother, by reason, a socially valid polygamous marriage, a man may be a conjunctural united with each of his wives and respectively two in one flesh, both in carnal sense and in terms of the kinship. Understand that. So, brothers and sisters, in my conclusion, the last thing I wanted to touch on was, polygamy. Those that love to say polygamy is condemned by the Apostle Paul, when he addressed the qualifications of the deacons, who are essentially elders, like I stated earlier. You know, the deacons and elders had to be the husband of one wife. 1 Timothy 3:12, and Titus 1:6. Now, I suggest that. Now, I'm not going to lie. I'm going to keep it 100. I used to think that a bishop could only take one wife. until the spirit, you know, revealed to me that that was off. You know, as I brought out earlier, you know, the priest had more than one wife. Jehoiada, the priest, had two wives. 2 Chronicles 24, verse 3. 2 Chronicles 24, verse 3. He had two wives. Now, first of all, brothers and sisters, you know, when we address Titus and 1 Timothy 3 and 2 and 12, this passage, or these passages, is not addressed to all believers. That's the first thing I want to put out here. These passages are not addressing all believers through the spirit of Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah, but only applies to the elders and deacons. That's the first thing we want to put out. Period. Then the next thing, we cannot take something that only applies to a specific group of men and apply that to all men in general. That's the first thing that needs to be known. This would be taking a verse out of its context. So secondly, notice that the passage do not say only one wife. Now I want you to pay particular attention to my words. Read my lips. Hear me well. I'm going to say it again. Second thing I want you to take notice to is the passage do not say only one wife. Now the Greek word that one is translated from is the word 3391, Strong's, Maya, M-I-A. And it's also translated as A. It is also translated as A. But don't believe me. Please don't believe me. Go and check it out for yourself. The first, it is translated as well. It is also translated as A. And it's also translated as the first. So in other parts of the scriptures, we read that, you know, this emphasis that would be that an elder needs to be a married man when we break it down into practical purposes. The elder needs to be a married man having children and that he must not have divorced his first wife or the first, as that word one is also translated as. And you need to understand that. For example, no, I give you a passage. The word A is the same word translated as one when we look it up in Strong's number 3391. So, prove all things. Go to the book of Matthew 21 and 19. And when he saw a fig tree in the way. So we see here, it's translated as A. We go to Matthew 26 and 69. Now Peter sat without in the palace, and a damsel came unto him. We see it again. It's translated as A. In Revelation 19 and 13, and the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice. It's the same word, but it's translated differently here in these scriptures that I just gave. So likewise, elders and deacons are to be the husband of a wife. You see, that word could have been translated as one, or it could have been translated as A. And that's the point that I need to drive home. When you look up these things, sometimes you have to look at it in the Hebrew and Greek. And that's where a lot of men are going off. They're telling you, you don't need to say the name of the Hamashiach. You could call him anything you want, man. That's off, man. But I don't want to go into that. I don't want to go into that. But did you catch that? So, we could retranslate that to the deacons are to be the husband of a wife. Meaning he can't be seen of a wife and have children. Because if he cannot rule his own household, how can he rule the assembly of Yahushua? So, in order to be a deacon, you have to have a wife. And to show that you can rule your own home, your own wife, and your own children. Understand that, understand that, and overstand that. So this passage, you know, in 1 Timothy and in Titus, does not limit him to only one wife. That's my point. That is not what the scriptures is trying to bring out. The purpose for this qualification is stated in 1 Timothy 3 and 5. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the assembly of Yahweh? That's the point. That's the point. The point is that he must be able to rule his wife and his children. And by that example, he can show that he could also have a possibility of being capable of ruling men and women in the congregation. Do you understand? Do you understand? And if he has multiple wives and is able to rule them, so much better. But it does not mean he can't have multiple wives. I showed you in the Old Testament where the priest had two wives. So any man who can love and rule multiple women and make them happy according to the word of the Most High is certainly qualified to rule a congregation of many believers. Understand that? Do you understand? And you know the last example I want to bring out, the other translation of that word, you know, how the word is one is translated, is when the scriptures speak of Yahweh Shah having risen on the first. That same translation where it's used one in Peter, in 1 Peter and Titus, when we look at other scriptures, it is translated as the first. On the first day of the week, Matthew 21 and 8, Mark 16 verse 2, Mark 16 verse 9, Luke 24 verse 1, John 20 verse 1, and John 20 verse 19. So the phrase is translated from the same word that one is translated from. It's translated from the same word. So I mean, they threw that in there. And so you got brothers, you got Israelites that's not reading the Hebrew and Greek and say, well, this is what it means. This is what it means. But it's not saying that. I gave you various scriptures and showing you where throughout our history, Israelites had multiple wives. And not once was it condemned in the scriptures. So who are you to condemn it? So the first is translated from that same word, one, that was translated, you know, in 1 Peter and in Titus. And, you know, knowing thus, it can also read as follows. Elders and deacons are to be the husbands of the first wife. Now, I know many of you are going to say that don't make sense, but I'm just showing you that the word could be translated as one, it could be translated as a, or it could be translated as the first. Do you understand? Do you understand? So again, the only purpose of that scripture, brothers and sisters, was for the qualifications stated in 1 Timothy 3 verse 5. For if a man know how to rule his own house, if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the assembly of Yahweh? So if an elder or if a bishop was divorced from his first wife, he would be violating the laws of the Most High, you know, regulating polygamy, which states if he takes him another wife, her food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall not be diminished. And many of you men in Israel, you're putting your wives away, but you're not taking care of them anymore. You're not taking care of them anymore. She can't go and marry anyone else. You have a responsibility. You wanted many wives, right? Book of Exodus 21 verse 10. So in other words, brothers and sisters, if an elder or a bishop was not still married to his first wife because of a divorce, but married to another woman, then he would be diminishing his first wife's food, raiment, and her duty of marriage, and therefore evidences that he does not know how to rule his own house, and therefore cannot rule the assembly of the Most High, and he's not qualified to be an elder, a bishop. Do you understand? do you understand? So, you know, some of you might say, wow, Tyler, I don't really like that interpretation. You know, that the elder needs to be, you know, a married man with children because, you know, they say Paul was an elder, but Paul was a single man. But, however, brothers and sisters, the scriptures does not say Paul was an elder. Now, even though Paul was unmarried in 1 Corinthians 7 verse 8, when we, you know, when we take a glance at the Lindo and Scott's Greek English Lexicon word study, you know, it reveals that unmarried could also mean a bachelor, or it can mean a widow, a widower, someone that was once married and, you know, their spouse died. So, you know, then you, if knowing that, if you look at the parallelism, you know, in 1 Corinthians 7 verse 8, unmarried refers to widowers and not to any bachelors or single persons. So Paul himself could have been a widower. You must understand that. Especially since the Bible implies that Paul was married as a Pharisee. So him being a Pharisee, and according to Acts 23 verse 6 and Acts 26 and 5, Paul must have been married because there was no single Pharisees to my knowledge. And if there was, please help me out. And Paul also defends himself with, you know, his prerogative to take a wife and bring her on his journey with him as the other apostles in 1 Corinthians 9 and 10. So brothers and sisters, with that, you know, if you can't see that polygamy is permitted by the scriptures, not according to me, according to what was brought out through the Spirit, then you don't want to see. You don't want to see. And if you do see it, and you still, you know, let someone tell you that, well, polygamy is wrong, then you're off. Then you're off. No matter who you think your leader or, no matter how wise you think him to be, if someone is wrong, they're wrong. Now, it's okay to say that, well, polygamy is allowed, but it's just not for me. It's just not for me. But do not teach that it's wrong. Do not teach that something is permitted by the Most High in Hamashiach is wrong if the scriptures say that it's right. And with that, I'm going to say shalom once again. This is Kahan Tazadot. I'm going to say shalom, yashallah.
This video was a throwback, but it is very, very relevant today. Be certain to subscribe to the channel, like this video, and tune into our weekly podcast on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, the Analytics of Love and Life podcast. Thank you for watching. Subscribe now.